Okay, good morning, everybody. My name is Keisha Hugh, and I am the creator of Professional School Counselors of Color. And this morning or night where you are, we're going to be talking about how I became a school counselor abroad. And my guest for this platform or panel this morning or tonight is Mr. Eric Nunez, who is a college counselor in Shenzhen, China. And he's in the bottom box. And the top box next to me, right there, we have Miss Yolanda. Yolanda, please say your last name for me because I always jack it up.
Yolanda Kukuya. Kukuya.
Okay. Kukuya. Yolanda Kukuya. And she is a school counselor all the way in Kuwait. And for those of you who don't know me, I am a school counselor in Guangzhou, China. And we're all working with high school students, right?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Yes. 9-10.
Okay. So what I want to do is I just want you to briefly introduce yourselves to our guests who are watching so they can know a little bit more about your educational background and what you're currently doing.
Sure. Miss Yolanda.
Okay. So hi, and I'm Yolanda. This is my fifth year as a school counselor in Kuwait. I'm grades 9 and 10. I started my education undergrad at Washington State University in Washington, and then I went over to Lewis and Clark College in Portland, Oregon. Probably a month and 3 weeks after I graduated, I found this position, and I came over with maybe like 2 weeks before school was about, like 14 days before school was about to start. Before that, I knew that I wanted to be international. I think the day I went to my interview for grad school, one of my college professors said that she was a school counselor in Switzerland, and I was like, the second she said that, I was like, done. Tell me more about this before I even got into the program. So yes. I got in the program clearly, and then as soon as I got in, I was researching University of Northern Iowa International Job Fair. I went. I wasn't interested in any schools or anything like that, but I ended up getting my job, you know, months down the line. So that's how I came here. I mean, I'm sure there's gonna be more. There's gonna be more said, but Eric, he's got to talk. So hey.
Good, Eric.
It's okay. So indeed, Eric Nunez, I am in Shenzhen right now. Prior to this, I'm a little bit different than the other panelists here today because I'm not a social emotional counseling. I'm just college counseling and a little bit of, a significant amount of training the local Chinese staff in what it is to be a college counselor. So prior to this, for about 9.5 years, I was in higher ed, in higher education, doing international international admissions. So I would go out and recruit the students to come to the United States and study at a variety of universities that I represented over the course of 9.5 years. So working in various universities, I lived in Los Angeles as well as New York. And so that whole time, like Yolanda was saying, kind of like that little bug of my, I visited all these amazing places and I would ask the counselors, how did you get here? How did you get to do this? Right, exactly. So how did you get to living in Bogota, Colombia, or, you know, Accra, or how did you get to living in Switzerland? My goodness. So I realized that I obviously don't have a social emotional counseling background. So my options were different, and we'll probably get into that later. I was just looking at college counseling positions. So then after about, like I said, 9.5 years, I put the sort of my resume out and got this position, which is unique because it's definitely, you need the experience in the admission side to really help the staff here understand kind of how admission is done. So China was not on my list. I'm sure we'll talk about where we are. China was not number one on my list. Shout out to all the Chinese people maybe joining us. But it has definitely been an amazing experience, and I'm sure we'll get into that. So. I took a leap of faith and a 16-hour flight, and voila, here I am.
Yes.
Exactly.
So I'll tell a little bit about myself. I I graduated from the College of New Rochelle with a master's in guidance and counseling. I also attended Alabama A&M University. All my HBCU people out there, where I had a master's degree in secondary education, social studies. So I am a history teacher. And I decided to go back to school because counselors, they run in my family, school counselors. So I knew that it was something that I was going to do. Oh, here comes Robin. Hold on.
Please hold. The doctor is coming in.
Yes. Oh, yes.
The doctor's in the house.
Yes, she's here. So, okay, so going back, Robin, we're just giving brief introductions to ourselves. So I'm in the middle of mine, and then you can start. I was teaching at a private school in Manhattan for about maybe 7 years. And then I wanted to work in counseling, and there was a hiring freeze. So New York City was not hiring anybody, and I tried to find something, and I couldn't. And I just randomly found the position on the Ask a Scene website, and I applied, and I got it. So that is how I got to Guangzhou, China. And I will tell you more about that in a little bit. Robin?
Hi, everyone. Sorry I'm late. I had some technical difficulties. I am an educator at heart. Let's see, where should I begin? I'm from Florida, and I started my educational journey teaching English. My first degree was English, and I obtained that degree from Florida A&M University. And then I went back because I kept pulling students out of my classroom to talk to them in the hallway, and I got my master's in school counseling. 2 years ago, I got my doctorate in educational leadership. The master's was also at FAMU. And my doctorate is from Clark, Atlanta. I've actually been on the list, because I love HBCUs. I've been on the list for 10 years. I work for the federal government, the Department of Defense. A lot of people will say, oh my gosh, you've been on the list for 10 years. Well, here's the thing. Everything that you do, it prepares you for the next phase. So. Yeah. The cool slash interesting thing about me being in South Korea, my little brother and his wife and my nephews are over here. So I have family in South Korea with me. I started writing books. So I'll tell you a little bit more about that, but that's a little bit about me.
Excellent. Okay, so now that you have the opportunity to meet us all, we have two in South, one in South Korea, one in Kuwait, and two in China. So I want you guys who are watching the broadcast to get your questions. There's going to be a time after we do our panel part that you can ask all sorts of questions. In the live chat, you're going to see Vet. That is Yvette. She's a school counselor in Thailand. So occasionally, every so often, she will put questions. She is definitely someone that you can ask if we are in the middle of a conversation. You can ask Yvette anything. She also knows. Again, she's in Thailand. So to everybody else, let's begin. So my first question is, what is the difference between doing counseling, whether it's college or school-related counseling? What is the difference between doing it in the United States and doing it abroad? What are some of the things that you are experiencing? How is it the same? How is it different?
Yeah.
I'll start. I came from Georgia. I was at a high school, and I'd been at that high school for 7 years in that county. And so when I got the call, I was wanting to go back to middle school. So I'm in middle school now. The county was transitioning, trying to go with ASCA. And of course, there are certain things that you know that you're really not supposed to do. So a few of the biggest things were to get into this organization and to do things that you haven't been doing. But because they're paying you to do things such as lunchroom duty, test coordinator. And I say those things like it's not really what we're supposed to do according to ASCA. However, I've been trained along the way in those 10 years to actually do these things effectively. So it's, I'm not supposed to, but it's part of the job, so you do it. So, you know, those are some of the little quirky, funny little things. I also had to get used to not seeing the kids as much. So that lunch duty is when I can see all the kids. And I have started my own routine with talking to them if something has occurred, you know, just, okay, following up. So it has its perks, but you kind of have to figure that out. And that's definitely different. Because before, okay, it was automatic.
Okay. Yolanda?
Okay. Some of the things I noticed that are different, especially to Kuwait, it's the resources. When I was working, or interning, but really working in Portland public schools, like, there was a resource for it. Like, there was a resource for everything, you know? Like, I had, you know, homeless kids, and I mean, I could go get bus vouchers, I could get them a place to live or something. Anything I needed, there was always like a third party resource that would help us. So I never needed anything, or, you know, if I needed to call CPS or anything like that, but there was always some type of organization that was there. In Kuwait, you learn how to be really, really creative with your resources. Because the thing is, in the US, there's the government, they take care of you. I mean, it doesn't matter who you are, they take care of you. In Kuwait, there's the government, but everything is, in a way, sort of run by families. So if something happens to a kid, for example, a kid is being abused at home, you can't call the police because it might be like this high-ranking family, and they're not going to arrest this person who's a high-ranking family. If a child is being, you know, sexually abused, in Kuwait, it's considered like the child is the property of the father. So they're like, in a way, the father can do with whatever he wants to with his property. So it's like, you have to come up with very, very, very creative ways of handling things. So I'm like, I've had to, in a way, I've had to walk away from my training as a school counselor. I mean, I haven't walked away because it gave me a really great foundation, but I had to go in a completely different direction of like, okay, this is a culture that I'm in. I need to work within the culture. How can I best like keep my kids safe? And again, I mean, my kids are safe. They come from like really good families, but in these situations, like, how can I best use the environment that I'm in to keep my kids safe and advocate for them? So I definitely want to say it's resources. And again, it's just like, it's families run things. Like, families run things. So I've had several families, not several, but like two or three, they get upset with you and they say they're going to deport you. You know what I mean? Or I've been threatened to like get arrested, deported, and sued. But you know what I mean? But in the US, like, you're kind of like taken care of, you know what I mean? But like, you legit can get deported over here. Like, there's no safety net. Luckily, I have like a really great support system with my administration, and they're not going to let something silly like that happen. But, you know, so I feel like if you're not getting attacked, you're not making moves. So, but yeah, that's okay. my biggest stuff.
Okay. Well, I think that's so interesting because it's like, you would expect, you know, coming from the United States into a different country, that our roles would kind of be the same as what we've been doing or what we know them to be. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, when you come, it's just like, wait, what? Because yeah. In my experience, and I had my experience in the States is very small. I only did counseling for a year while I was teaching. And then I came here. So this is like my first full-time school counseling gig. And when I got here, I'm just like, okay, I know the resources and I know all of these things, but you're in China. And in China, there are so many systems that we have at home that are not in place, especially dealing with students with like learning disabilities, or there's a child that you see and you're like, wow, you know what? This kid needs to be evaluated. There isn't any special education services. Mm-hmm. And fortunate for us, we're about an hour and a half away from Hong Kong. And Hong Kong, there's a lot of westernized therapists, the autism specialists, and things like that. So if you get a parent who is willing to actually take the child to get evaluated so that we know how to better help them, then that's great. But within the culture, there's this thing that's called saving face. Anything that's going to bring embarrassment to the child or the family, they will not do it. And correct. It's like, how do you help these people, the parents, the students, to say, we're a partnership. You don't have to feel afraid that if I know that we will, you know, dismiss the child from the school. That's not the case. It just helps us to know how to help them. And that is a losing battle. Guangzhou is in a province called Guangdong. And Guangdong is hella big, really, really big. And when I was looking for resources for a student who was exhibiting suicidal ideation, right? I'm looking for all of these resources to see, well, maybe I can find a mental health center. Imagine the size of a state, or a place the size of Texas, maybe about three times the size of Texas. And in that whole space, there's only like four mental health providers. So when you're dealing with a serious situation, and I'm like, oh, you need to tell me in this big place, there's only four and they're all spaced out. You know, so that's hard coming from a place where you basically have everything at the tip of your fingers, first world problems.
Mm-hmm. Right. You know what I mean? Right. Well, I definitely echo everything that's been said. I think that the biggest challenge, and again, I don't come from a social emotional background, but I've seen the importance of blending that into what is a college counseling role, which is what I do. A colleague of mine is like Dr. Robin Medlock. He's also a graduate of the social emotional background and it has his doctorate. And he's in the same position I'm in, and he's found it very difficult because of the cultural things we mentioned. Mental health is something definitely not covered in China. So you can kind of add that to a few other countries in the world, really, like Kuwait, as was being mentioned. I'm sure in South Korea as well is the same sort of WASTA, I think it's called in the Middle East, right? See, we have teachers from the Middle East come this year and they say WASTA. And I'm like, what's WASTA? The concept of face, which is saving face, which exists, I know, in South Korea as well, in Japan. You don't want the family. Sorry?
WASTA means influence.
There you go. Well, yeah, it's Guanxi is really where it would be here. Guanxi, that's the exact thing. But it's basically that the parents refuse to acknowledge that. So I've had kids that I've told the counselors just from a perception. I said, I believe this kid maybe could use some more deeper conversations with obviously an expert. And the parents, you know, the counselor, I try to give them language to phrase that as culturally appropriately as possible with the parents, but the parents don't even have it. The kid goes to the university and then has a breakdown. So I've had a trickle of kids coming back from university that have had serious mental health breakdowns, nervous breakdowns, anxiety, homesickness, and a variety of other adjustment issues that the parents dealt with by receiving them at the airport and dumping them into the psychiatric hospital. So it's a developing nation in the fact that it's growing in the awareness of mental health. So that's been one of the biggest things for me, is really that. Expectations, I'm sure, are different. What parents expect you to be doing and what they understand your role to be sometimes is a little bit different and a challenge. And I'll echo what Yolanda said, which is resources. I think that I came very naively as well from the US. This is my first time living outside the US, though I've traveled a lot, and I thought I'm from New York City. I'm very culturally aware. I got it. My parents are Cuban. I speak another language, several languages. What's the big deal? You know, the adjustment issues were not insurmountable. Obviously, I'm still here 3 years later. But and very happy. But I think in the beginning, it was professionally getting used to different colleagues and the way that they see, the way that they organize their professional life is very different. The way that they advise students is very, very different than the United States, needless to say. The conversations they have and the knowledge they had about universities and about resources and things were very, very different. So there was a lot of sort of two-way learning. I learned a lot about the way they do things here, but they learned a lot as well about the way that things are done in the services that are offered in the U.S. So many of you guys joining us tonight from the U.S., you might be complaining about lack of resources in your school and so forth, but there's other challenges when you come abroad as well. So, yeah.
I kind of want to go back a little bit because the conversation is like so good, but I have to keep in mind that we're trying to tell people, firstly, how to get jobs overseas.
Yes.
So when you got to the point where, because I know for people who are just logging in, because I see new people are coming, yeah. Robin got her job through the Department of Defense. I got mine through ASCA, but I realized that my school is affiliated with an agency called International School Services. Yolanda, is your school affiliated with an agency?
No, it's not. My current school, not. I don't know about my future school that I'm going to.
Okay. Now, when you got the job, when you first of all, let's talk about the interview process. How was that for you? How were you able to interview, and who did you interview with?
Who are you asking?
Okay, so you mean
all of you. So anybody can.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So do you mean like the overall jobs that I interviewed that I turned down that I didn't get, or just the current one that I have right now?
Is this your first school international?
Yeah, this is my first school.
Okay, yes. So yeah, this one. Let's talk about this one.
Okay, well, this one may not be that helpful because I thought it was, in a way, a joke. So, it was like the summer. I gave myself a timeline, like I'm gonna find a job, whatever. So I was up, applying to jobs every single day, every single morning. It was my job, right? And so finally, I just want to let you know, if you're going to be international and you have no experience, lower your standards, okay? I thought I was going off to Germany. I thought I was going to wear cute boots and nice coats and live that European lifestyle. And they were like, no, it's not going to happen. So please just expect it. Lower your standards. You're going to go to Asia. You're going to go to the Middle East. That's where you're going to get your start. And then you can go wherever you want. Mm-hmm. So I finally lowered my standards, whatever, and so I started applying everywhere, right? And then a day after I applied to the school that I'm currently at right now, the director contacted me. He's like, hey, I'd like to speak to you. And I'm like, sure, why not? Didn't really care. And then he's like, okay, well, I'll call you tomorrow. Okay, he calls me tomorrow. I'm upstairs on my mother's chaise lounge in my pajamas talking to him. I thought it was just going to be like a, hey, how you doing type of situation. And he goes into like an interview. So I'm like, okay, let's do this, whatever. And apparently he heard something that he really liked, or he was really desperate because the counselor who was there before decided to leave 2 days before. So they needed a warm body, you know? And so he said, well, I need to call your references. I'm like, sure, go ahead. You know, call my references. And then about 30 minutes later, he says, hey, would you like to move to Kuwait? And I'm like, not really, but I'll take the job. You know?
That's honesty, everyone. That is really honesty.
Well, the thing is, I'm moving to China, and all these beautiful people are leaving China. So I'm moving to China next year to go to Shanghai American School. Shame on you two. But the thing is, all the interviews that I did not care about, I got.
Yes.
I mean, Shanghai American, I thought it was a joke that they wanted to talk to me. I was like, okay, I'm going to talk to this fancy school just to tell my friends that I did it. And I go in there, I'm just saying whatever I want to say. I'm messing up. She's completely loving it. I interview with the director. Didn't know that the director was the director, and I'm just shooting the poop with them. And they're like, we really like you. I'm like, you should, you know? And then they hate me. And they
hate me. I feel embarrassed for you.
The more that you don't care, I swear, the more that you don't care, the more that they want you. You know, I mean, I was in the lobby when she offered me the job, and I was just trying to like chit chat with people. So, I mean, that's all I can say. Like, the less you care about it, the more they want you.
Well, I don't know. I think my experience is a tad different.
Yeah.
But I did apply with Teachaway, and I did have a phone interview with Kuwait. And at the time, I did have an uncle, still have an uncle in Kuwait. I got to the second round of the interviews, and it was so funny, the lady interviewing me, she wasn't a counselor, wasn't a director. So it's like, what qualifications do you even have? But whatever, lady, I answer the questions. And when she got to the point about me moving over, I said, well, what will I bring? She said, do you have questions? Because I'm thinking, I need to be moving my whole household. She said, you just bring your suitcase. I said, and what about my mother? Because at this time, my mother has moved in with me. She's in the States now, but, well, you can't bring your mother. I was like, oh, okay. So she called right back, and I guess she realized that we were a package deal. And I didn't move on to the next level. I didn't think anything of it, and I was like, whatever. So the school year this year started 15-16, and I was at my high school, and I just knew something was going to happen because last year, school year 14-15, I got an email from Lakeithan Middle School with the Department of Defense. I said, it's starting. So I didn't hear anything back, and that's in England, so I didn't hear anything back. And the school year started the first week in August, the 3rd. I got an email that morning prior to me going to work. And I didn't even think about the time difference, but it was like, would you be interested in an interview, Eastern Standard Time, blah, blah, blah. As it turns out, the same day that I get the email that morning, as I'm driving home from work in my car, I'm being interviewed by the principal.
Oh, wow.
So I was like, totally not prepared. I mean, but I've been doing counseling for 12 years. So, and I've done middle and high. So the questions she asked me, a lot of them did not relate to counseling at all. It was about time management, multitasking, and just, you know, how do you handle change? Nothing about how do I deal with parents. There were a couple questions about ethics, and I've dealt with that in my past. And so I just was straight up with her. I answered her questions, and I was able to give her examples for each question that she gave me. And it almost was like I was talking to my friend. I was like, this is kind of a strange interview. Anyway, she said, well, I'm going to give you a call back. And so that Friday, I got offered the job. So, and she said I was the top candidate. So I was like, okay. And I shared that my brother was already over here. And she was like, really? I was like, yep. So, and here I am.
Well, like everyone has said, one thing to remember about this process, when you start into, everybody can hear me, I hope, is that it does move quickly sometimes. I mean, I went from a point where I even interviewed actually, oh, can you hear me? Can you see me? Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Good. So, I think Keisha is either shocked or frozen.
I think Keisha's frozen. You go ahead, Eric.
Okay. So it does move very quickly. So from the interview, from the actual posting to the interview, I looked at my email the other day looking at it. Oh, she got knocked out. And it was probably a span of about 2 weeks, I think. I think I submitted my resume and they called me like a week and a half later. And if you hear from the experiences that Yolanda talked about in interviewing and Robin just mentioned, I think you can kind of hear the undertone of what they experienced with the prior candidate or the position and what they're looking for. So in Robin's case, I think that they definitely had somebody, hey, welcome back,
guys.
They probably had somebody.
Okay. It's the firewall.
No, right? China got us.
Okay.
With Robin's
case, everybody else probably, went.
I don't know. Everybody's here.
Yeah.
Some university, some
is colleges. Everybody going? Is it just us?
No, it's not just us. We're here.
Robin, you're there, right?
Yeah.
We're all here. We're all
here. To the other here. People. Oh my God.
You can't see everybody else?
They will. Here. Okay, good. Event is present.
Okay, good.
Okay, so this is wonderful that it happened, because for those of you who are watching, here's the thing. If you're coming to places like China, if you're going, you know, where there's restrictions on certain websites, you have to get what they call a VPN.
Yes.
VPN is a device where you can, I guess it kind of, I'm not very technological or, you know, with that stuff, but it enables you to, for your browser to be someplace else so that you can access. Sometimes the VPNs work great and you can access websites like Facebook and YouTube. And other days it really sucks, like today in the middle of the broadcast. So, oh, thank you, Eric, because you know I didn't know. Virtual private network. Eric, yes. I can't see you, so I'm going to boot you out and then call back in. Okay?
Can you see him?
Unless,
can you see him?
You see him?
I can see him.
Talking?
I can see you, Keisha.
I can see him here.
I don't see him.
Really? I'm right here.
I only see you.
Yeah, we can see and hear him.
Eric.
Yeah, see, Yvette can see me, too.
I'm going to boot you out, and I'm going to boot Yolanda out. Call back in.
You got it. Okay.
Why are you going to boot me out?
My computer doesn't love me.
Don't boot me
okay.
out.
Okay. Can they hear me?
We can hear.
Okay.
It's you, Keisha. It's not us.
All right. I'm going to boot them out. Eric, call back in. Yolanda, call back in.
Bye, guys.
Okay. Eric is calling in. Okay, there's Eric.
On the top now, switch sides.
Okay, good. Yolanda is calling in. All right, we're right here.
Good.
Cute profile picture, Eric.
Awesome. Yeah. So what I was saying, as far as like when you're going to these different countries, wherever you may seek employment and you get it, please don't expect everything to work the way that you're accustomed to in the United States. That's why we say hashtag first world problems.
Yes.
Be yeah.
And with our first world selves, we will become very annoyed that, oh my gosh, my Wi-Fi is not working, or I can't access this, or I can't access that. This is all a part of it. Yvette, who is in our in the live chat section, she was in Uzbekistan. So you know.
Girl.
Okay, so going back. Did you finish? Did they hear what you had to say?
No, it's just about.
No, Eric didn't get it finished. Yeah.
It was about the experiences with interviewing. You can hear kind of what the administrations are looking for. So Robin mentioned that they were like, are you organized? Are you this? Are you that? It's probably because the person before lacked those things and they're looking for that in the next candidate.
It was actually the opposite. She had it. And see, when I got there, I was late. So I was helter skelter. And for a while, I was like, this is not working. I'm about to go back to the U.S. of A.
Yes. Yes.
It's not working. But it's much better.
Yeah. And there's websites that also, we'll probably talk about that. There's something called International School Review.
Yes.
Where you can actually get the feedback from, sorry, no one said that. You can get the feedback from colleges, high schools, specifically, hey, there you are. So in case any administrators are in the room, so you can know what you're getting into, but ultimately, like I wrote there, patience and understanding, you're not gonna have the same resources definitely that you had before. It's obviously a different working environment. We are all pretty resilient people and understanding, but sometimes the reality of living in a different culture and living in a different place, and then an administration that is likely from all over the world as well. I work with just Chinese staff, for example, but my direct teachers are from all over the world as well. So the staff is used to a different way of doing things. They're not used to particular resources maybe being available or ways of doing things. So just keep that in mind as you guys, when you're coming abroad, flexibility is number one. Flexibility, breathe in and say, this is, insert your country. This is South Korea. This is Kuwait. This is China, or wherever you might be. Yeah.
I know, like, for my interview process, it was interesting. I sent the email to the director of the school with my resume, and he said, you know, I'm going to review it, and if there's a fit, I'll let you know. So that was, like, This is 2014. This is like the last week in January. He hits me up 2 days later and says, hey, can we set up an interview? So I'm like, okay, fine. It just so happened that he was on vacation because it was a holiday. He was in South Africa. And so what you'll find that for a lot of international schools, when they want to meet with you or interview with you, it will be done either phone call or Skype. And I did my interview via Skype and it went well. It was about maybe about an hour. He asked me a lot of questions, like as far as like my experience and how, like, organizational skills, how do you respond to setbacks? When they ask you certain questions like that, it's because, especially if your school is new, they want to know, you know, listen, it's not going to be an easy journey. You're going to have to do a lot of things and things may not be in place. And we need to know that you're going to be a team player and that you can just, you know, roll up your sleeves and get your hands dirty. Again, it's different from working in the United States and you're working at a new school. This is, you're coming to a new country, you're going to a new school, you have to learn what the culture is like and just adjusting. So those are really, really big things that you got to think about. After I interviewed with him, I also had to interview with the, she's kind of like the creator of the school. And I interviewed with her maybe about a day later. And then after that, maybe I would say maybe about 24 hours later, I had a message in my inbox with a offer letter. I didn't
24 hours later.
Yes, I didn't expect it to happen so quickly. And I was like, oh, snap, what? Seriously? This can't be real. And I asked how long would I be, you know, have to think about it? Now, there are international school fairs, depending if you are registered with ISS, which is the International School Services, or Search Associates or whatever other agency there may be that helps international teachers to go, teachers and counselors to go abroad. When they have these career fairs, you're going there as a paid registered member of this website, and you get to meet with all of these directors, principals of these schools. And so you can be literally offered a job on the spot. Now, the reason why they gave me such a short time, and I was in New York at the time, they said, we need to know in like 4 days. And to me, I'm like, that's not a lot of time to, you know, this is a big life decision. But the reason why they had given me such a short amount of time is because they were interviewing other candidates right then and there. So it's like, if you don't take it, we'll ask someone else. So sometimes you just have to jump at the opportunity. You don't have
look
to
at what Yvette said on the side. Not to cut you off, but look at what Yvette said on the side. She was at Search last time. Remember, Yvette is joining us from Thailand, and she's coming to Shenzhen. And she got a notice in under 8 hours, and then yes, had 24 hours after discussing that to get back to them. So that's how quick, like Keisha was saying, that's how quick it happens.
Yeah, so, you don't get that time to be like, okay, I got a month to think about it. No, sometimes it's just like instant. And then what she said, I signed it after.
I had a week and a half.
A week and a half. So some places will be different. It depends on where you are. Now I have, let me see. Okay, so what? Tell me a little bit about what the culture is like at your school. Like as far as like a typical day or, you know, what is it like there?
It's middle school. They're off the chain. They're cute and funny and nasty at the same time. You know, somebody who picks their eye mucus and eats it. I mean, you know, it's middle school. We have occasional fights. small number. But for the most part, our kids are really, really good. Really good for the most part. They like to be on the honor roll. everybody eats lunch at the same time. Students are really respectful. They say, yes, ma'am. And at my school, everybody's American, whether they're Korean American, African American. My school is actually on a military base, which that is definitely interesting because I'm a straight up civilian, and that's what I tell everybody. So when you have to go and get your license and everything, and they say, well, where do you work? DOD, you know, everybody works for DO, the Department of Defense, but I'm all the way a civilian, so I don't know all these other terminologies. But anyway, the school is good for the most part. The kids are respectful. They don't do their homework. We have a D and an F list that comes out every week. Lots of kids are on there. But by the time it's report card time or awards time, you know, most kids are getting the honor roll.
Wanda?
Okay. So my kids. Okay. So my school is probably the third best school in Kuwait. And the only reason why it's the third best is because it's bilingual. So the schools that are above it is like the American International School of Kuwait and the American School of Kuwait. So they trump us because they're embassy schools, but like we're a pretty well-known, well-established school. So the type of kids and families that come to our school are like the top of Kuwait. So you are going to find the grandchildren of the emir, who's like the king of Kuwait. Like, you're going to find the grandchildren, you're going to find the great-grandchildren. I mean, it's just like the elite, the richest of the rich, the affluent, that's going to be my group of kids. Now, God bless them. I love my babies. I love them. But some of the most entitled human beings I have ever come across. I have ever come across. You know what I mean? And I tell them, and I tell the parents, anybody who asks them, like, my main issue is their entitlement and the why tribe. Like, well, you need to do better in a certain class, blah, blah. Why? I'm going to inherit my father's company. There's no point in me doing anything. And legit, how can I say that? How, even if they don't inherit something from their father, the government pays them money. Like, you get paid to be a Kuwaiti. If you're a Sabah from the ruling family, you get paid even more to be just a part of the royal family. I mean, it's an oil-rich country, so I mean, just like, there's, I mean, like, education is free. I mean, so the thing is, like, I don't know, like, still, it's my fifth year, I'm still trying to figure out how to motivate these kids beyond, I mean, have some type of intrinsic motivation, because it's just like, well, why? And I always tell my kids, I'm like, I hope and pray to God that your oil dries up and you guys have to get rid of all of your nannies and maids and drivers, and you guys have to work for what God should be giving you, know what I mean?
Nugget Yolanda, she's traumatized.
Yeah, I mean, I don't care. I'm like, deport me. You know, it's the truth. Right. You know what I mean? But yeah, our kids are just like, they're really entitled. Like, everybody has, almost everybody has at least two maids, two nannies, a driver, a cook. That's just the life that you have out there. And the thing is, like, so there's Western staff and then there's Arabic staff. So the thing is, a lot of Western staff, they're just like, we're going to do this. This is how things are strict. But because there's the Arabic staff who are living in Kuwait, and sometimes they're afraid of like the families, whatever. They'll let kids get away with stuff, whatever. But I'm American. You know what I mean? I'm like, I don't care where you're from or who you're from. All I know is you came out the same way that I came out, and that's it, whatever. But like, there's a huge discrepancy, but how like the Western staff and then like the Arabic staff treat cute children. But I mean, again, my babies, like, I love them. They can't, in a way, like, some of them can't help but be who they are because of how they're raised. And then there are other kids who are completely intrinsically motivated, sweet, down-to-earth kids, don't flash their money or anything like that. But I wouldn't have stayed 5 years if I didn't fall in love with them. I love these entitled kids, you know, but like, this is what it is. Like,
the best thing is that when they move on from here, they learn. Because yes. In China, we have similar issues. I like that in our panel, Dr. Robin there said, you know, that in her school, I talked about socioeconomic status. Remember, you guys are coming potentially to private schools. The parents are paying for this. So they're at a certain wealth status, some of them, not all of them. So it's good to see we have sort of socioeconomic diversity of our students as well. But indeed, like Yolanda was saying, at least in China, and I'm sure some of you have seen it, kids are very entitled. They just, you have to think like a teenager. So it's me. Yeah, I know what I know. I know what I want to do. Don't tell me what to do. So you got that on top of I've been coddled my whole life.
Yes.
My whole life has literally been lived in a silver spoon, especially because in Kuwait, not too long ago, they were very, very poor. The same thing in China. China has developed in the last 30 years. That has created a particular factor in society of people that just one generation ago didn't have this kind of wealth. So they've seen this tremendous wealth expand. And they just showed their kids what they didn't have. Kind of like we want our best for our kids. They showed the kids what they didn't have. Unfortunately, those kids don't know anything but a good life. So they have a very skewed view sometimes of the world and what people are there to help them, not serve them. So things to think about in the general sense of it. But I thought we had another question. Sorry.
There are bribes too. I get bribed all the time.
Yes.
I don't take it, but I get bribed all the time.
I actually, everything that you said, Yolanda, I could relate to in my job at China. Although there isn't any like royal family here, we have students who, like, for the most part, their parents are like business owners, and like some of them have really big businesses. So the families are extremely wealthy. Like the tuition at my school is $25,000 US a year. Okay. The campus is totally beautiful. It looks like a university. But you do have these kids who, you know, the parents are off working. And so these kids, they take care of themselves. Like, I have a kid right now. I'm like, where are you going for spring break? Oh, I'm going to Bali. Who's going with you? Just me and my friends. And I'm like, wait, what? Nobody's going with, no adults? No supervision? And that's normal. Now, what's interesting is this. Now, with exposure to certain Western staff, a lot of these kids they're learning about how to do things or what life may be like in the United States. And you can I see the development, I see the growth happening as far as change is concerned with their personalities. Some of them were very rigid before, now they're loosening up. They're becoming more comfortable with expressing themselves. And so I think that's a great thing about international education. My school is just straight Chinese nationals. The staff is Western. And like Yolanda pointed out, at my particular school, we do have Chinese local staff. And because a lot of them come from rural areas, and what I've realized is because a lot of the kids, they're coming from wealthy families, a lot of the local Chinese staff are afraid to talk to those kids in a certain type of a way, like as far as to disciplining or whatever it may be. I'm like, listen, I'm from America. I don't know who your parents are, but you need to be kind. You need to be doing all of these things. You treat everybody the same. You're not disrespectful to this person. This is an adult, you know? So it just goes to show that there's a lot of similarities across the board internationally. Now, Dr. Mason had a question. She wanted to know what is our caseloads like? How many students are we responsible for?
Some of us have been answering it, I see there, but yeah, okay. If you want to go on, yeah.
She'll come back. So initially, my first year, our school is in its fourth year of existence, so we have now we're graduating our first class. So my caseload was 135. Mm. Now we have an additional counselor, so it's smaller now. So my caseload is about maybe 80 students.
Wow, okay.
Wow.
Yeah.
And some of you can read there, you can see Yvette from Thailand has 200 students, 7 through 10. So it's a mixture, it seems, of middle school and high school. A little bit, so yeah.
Mine is 6 through 8, and I have 157 right now. It fluctuates. Again, I'm on a military base, so we have kids coming and going. So, it fluctuates.
Okay. And mine is very different. different because I'm just college counseling. So mine are, and we have six other staff members. I don't know if some of you ladies are one woman shows in your school or if you're just a staff.
One woman show. Just me. There you go.
So that might lead to the bigger case numbers in case some of you are looking at this, but I see somebody already, I think it was Dr. Mason who said, it already seems much smaller than the US.
Yeah,
that is true. The numbers could be much smaller and probably will be much smaller than what our projected numbers or averages in the US. I have just 15 students each year because I only do college counseling. And in our school, I work at a public school, but the structure in China, the kids still pay boarding and they're all pretty affluent kids. Regardless, because I work in the international center within my public school. So those kids, we've gotten them to talk a little more about seeking help to strengthen their applications as far as themselves, meaning like mental health things that I see in some of the kids, because we have honest conversations about what you should seek outside and also because they can afford that. But yeah. I'm just 15 students each year across 11 and 10 and 12 rather.
Okay, so the next question is, because we want to talk about what should school counselors who are interested in working abroad, what are some of the things that they need to think about as far as what the whole movement means, coming abroad, living abroad, not vacationing, but becoming an expat and culture shock. How did that affect you when you got here? What was that like for you guys?
Ooh-wee.
Right?
Well, this was my first overseas experience. Mm-hmm. And even though I'm coming to a military base, I had no idea about shipping my car. That was shipped for free. I didn't know that I was going to have to take a driver's license test. I had to take a Korean driver's license test. It was in English. It was in English. I had to pass that. My household goods were shipped up to 18,000 pounds. So waiting on that to arrive, you know, just all these different things that I wasn't told ahead of time. And I don't know if I was told because it was just so much paperwork. I don't really think you could be prepared for it until you get into it. And it was just so much because you have to have your ID card to get on base. You have to have your ID card to log into your computer. It took 2 weeks to get my ID card. You know, it was just all these different things. And then you live in some place where you can't communicate except when you're on base. I got two shipments. I got an unaccompanied baggage and that was like under 500 pounds. And then I got my other 3,000 because I didn't ship up to 8. I didn't ship 18. But anyway. I couldn't communicate. The guy rang the doorbell and here there's a picture that comes with like a TV screen. I didn't know what he was saying. I just knew I was off that day and I was receiving a shipment of my goods. And he's talking to me in Hangul and I don't know what he is saying. Finally, he gets to the door because somebody let him in because it's like a security feature. He gets to the door, rings that bell. I still have no idea what he's saying, but I know he is delivering something to me. And so there's a window outside of the main door. And I'm just trying to talk to him using my hands. And finally, I get him to understand that you want me to go outside with you. And, so it was difficult in that regard because stateside shipping my items, I dealt with Americans. Mm. So I was thinking I'm coming to a base. They're receiving my goods. You know, no one told me I was going to deal with Koreans who didn't speak English. They're going to be delivering your stuff. And you're just like, okay. And they don't speak a lick of English. Yep. But I received all my stuff and they unpacked it and, you know, took away the trash. But it was so many things that I just had no concept of, just none. You know, and it was in the beginning, it was almost like being a college freshman. You know, go to this building, get this sign, then go to that building, bring me that paper back, and then go to this building, and then get your ID card. It was just all these moving parts, and you're still working. Whereas if I was maybe military, I would have been off that time to handle those little intricate details, but I was still working. And then coming late, I was working a lot of times up until, you know, 7, 8 o'clock at night. Mm. And I had to tell my mother, who was like, you need to leave. Where am I going? I don't know the language. Yeah. I'm not going to movies just yet. I mean, there are things to do, you know, out with the locals, which is really cool. And I'm adjusting. But it's like, I just got here. I am really, you know, playing catch up. And as a counselor, it's so many things you have to do. So many things are going on. And then to be late, I was 3 weeks, actually 4 weeks late, because I didn't come the pre-planning part either, because I was at my school in the States. So it was a lot of catch up. But yeah, it was interesting. Glad that's over.
Definitely.
How was what?
The transition?
Yes.
It was unique. I think I had that sort of adventurous kind of international travel or travel bug. So and with admission, I was used to being out of the country 2, 3, 4 weeks at a time. And I would travel between September and December visiting high schools and so forth. So I was used to being on the road. That wasn't a thing. But I think about, it really hit me, I think, actually, I arrived in August. I arrived late as well because of visas and all these things. I arrived really late for the beginning of the year. So I arrived like late August. And then Thanksgiving was probably the first time it hit me, because by Thanksgiving, I would have already been home and eating that turkey and a variety of other things. And then I'm doing a Skype session with my parents at 9 a.m. on Friday morning. And it is like 9 p.m. New York time, as everybody's like, hey, we miss you. And I'm like, hey, everybody. All is good. Having my green tea and good morning from Asia, and I'm like, I'm by myself, and that's where it really hit me, like, what in the world did I do moving across the world, because you begin to miss home. I think that hits you probably after the vacation period leaves, and you find yourself, even though you've probably made friends by the 3 month mark, you'll find other Americans or other people and so forth, and you'll meet other expats. Oh, she's back. So you've made a community. I kind of had made already a little niche of people. Hey, but it hits you on the holidays. You're missing birthdays. You're missing holidays. That was the hardest part of the transition. The language factor, as Robin mentioned, Hangul is one thing. Hanyu here with the Chinese language is different. Getting deliveries as well. And I was like, chicken. The chicken is missing from the bag that I ordered, or tried doing an egg. Goodness. Things like that that are the fun and the frustrating. You got to see them as fun things of the experience, not as much frustrating. It made me think a lot of people coming to New York, and I'm like, wow, I really respect what my parents did. My parents came from Cuba to New York, and they didn't speak any English. So living here, boy, did that put that immigrant experience into perspective, where it was like, how did you all do this?
Mm-hmm. Eric, you went away.
Eric? Oh, he's calling back in. Okay, so I'll talk a little bit about mine. So Yolanda, what we're talking about is as far as like your transition period to like your new country. I know for me, I asked a lot of questions, and I had friends who, not necessarily who worked at international schools, because I didn't know about the opportunity, but I did ask friends who I knew taught like English in Korea or other places. And the first thing that they told me was that they, you know, once we get here, you know, as a Black person of color, they're not accustomed to really seeing us. And so they're going to stare. They're going to look at you. If you're heavy set, they're definitely going to stare at you. You have dreadlocks like I do. They're going to look at you. They're going to want to touch you. They'll take pictures and all of these things. And I was careful to say, okay, I'm going to keep that in mind, because your experience won't necessarily mean that's going to be mine. Yeah. And once I got, I just kept an open mind. I would watch videos to try to pick up key little Chinese words that I could use, like maybe the numbers or just little sayings or whatever. And then I got here. Now, when I came, our school director came with a big charter bus for us, picked us up from the airport and brought us to the campus. And like the campus, there's faculty housing and stuff. All of the local Chinese staff, they spoke English. So for that first school year, we practically lived in a bubble. The only time that we
What's going on?
Am I still on? Sorry.
I don't eat pork. I don't eat certain things. So I'm always careful to ask, what is this? You know, is like oink, 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 or like pop, 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 pop. And it would become such a game that they would laugh and we would.
Yeah. Keesh.
China, everyone, welcome to the beauties of being in China, like she said.
Okay. Korea has great energy.
So, like,
excuse me.
Just trying to, you know, express yourself. You have to come in with an open mind. And you have to, when you first come, you'll enjoy it because it's going to be something new. You have to keep in mind that culture shock is a very real thing. And when you're working a new job in a new school and have to deal with the culture shock, it's very taxing. When you come, there's like that stage. You come and you're excited. And then it's going to go down. You're going to get depressed. And you're going to be sad. And because the reason why you become depressed, you are trying to take the knowledge that you know, your everyday life and what you've experienced. And you're trying to make it make sense in your new country. So it's kind of like, remember when we were back in like kindergarten, when we started to learn shapes, you have to put the pegs in. It's like pushing a triangle peg in a circle peg. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. And then eventually you have to look at your new culture, understand it. And then when you get it, you'll be able to find your place and then you're able to do things, you know? So there may be sometimes you go out and somebody's just looking at you like in total disgust. You don't take it personally. You know what I mean? Like sometimes people stare at me all the time and I got to tell myself, you know what? I am in a rural area in Guangzhou. I'm probably the first Black person that ever came up in this piece. I'm probably the first one. So although if I was in New York, the way you're looking at me, I would get upset. I can't get upset. You know, I have to just woo-saw, woo-woo-woo. And hi, my name is so-and-so. Yes. You would like to touch my hair? Your hand's clean? Sure. Go ahead. Yeah. You know. And it becomes a teaching moment. Now, I don't mind doing it in that way because, again, they're getting to learn about me and what other, you know, people of color may be like or people with natural hair. But I've also had people look at me and come up and start touching me as if I'm not a person. And I think when they start doing that bothers me and it hurts because now it's like you don't see me as a human being. You don't see me as a human being because you just can't come up to someone and just start touching them like I'm not a mannequin. I'm not a puppy. I'm not a puppy, you know? And so it made me look really different like at certain things. When you go into the supermarket, everybody stops doing what they're doing. All of those things take a toll on you. So, like, I remember for the first couple of months, I refused to go to the store. I refused to go places because I couldn't handle the stress of going out because I know it would be a big thing. And I was going to get emotional about it. I couldn't do it. So I would find places where they would deliver my groceries to me because I would not go out. Anytime when we had a holiday break, I would go to a different country for break because I couldn't stand being here. But then after a while, you process it and you come to understand the culture. And, you know, technically, you become like an ambassador.
Yeah.
So I'm like, you know what? I am the ambassador for all Black people in this area. I can do one of two things. I can either get real Bronx or real Jamaican and just, you know, curse them to like the sun comes down. Or I can make it an educational experience for them. Because who knows who's the next Black person they may meet. And if I handle this in a negative way, they may classify all people this way. And I can't do that.
Here's a good question, if I could ask. Because I see many opportunities, particularly in the Professional School Counselors of Color Facebook page. Everyone should be on. Hey, quick plug. There's opportunities that are coming up for counselors. There's three of us that are in Asia. Southeast Asia specifically. So I see a lot of opportunities for like Abu Dhabi, Dubai, and other parts of the Middle East. And I'm sure, Yolanda, you might get this question, but what is it like being a woman, for example, and particularly a woman of color in the Middle East? So a lot of counselors are are women. So here I am in the dynamic of a lot of the counseling roles for some of the men that might be listening as well. But a lot of the counselors are women. And so a number one worry when they see a good school in like the Middle East region, let's say, is my goodness, all these stereotypes or all these preconceived things that the media is telling me about the Middle East. Am I going to be able to survive in Dubai? If only they knew. Yolanda, what is it like to live in Kuwait and the Middle East region in general, for example?
Thank you for that segue, Eric. That's what I wanted to get to.
Because I'm also curious about that myself, actually. So.
So the thing is, and I say this all the time, Kuwait is the safest place I have ever lived. I have never, ever, ever felt like at any time that anybody was going to like harm me or anything. I mean, I live somewhat what people say, like, the trap, the hood. It really isn't. I've seen other traps in like in Kuwait. This is not it, whatever. I don't have an issue with walking to the grocery store that's like about a 10-minute walk at 11:30 at night. No. I don't have any issues. If I go to Southern California and I live in a nice middle class white affluent neighborhood in Southern California, in Laguna Niguel area, the same distance of a walk, and I'm like, yeah, no, I'm not gonna do it. But here's the difference between Kuwait. Thing is, I get harassed 24/7. I will get propositioned for sex minimum. 5 times a day. I know how to ask for sex in Arabic and Bengali, the Palestinian dialect and the Egyptian dialect. I know how I get harassed every single day of my life.
Okay? Kisha's about to move to Kuwait, yes.
If I'm walking. However, it is the safest place I have ever lived. Now, the thing is, being a black female abroad, you're just going to get a lot of crap. Just expect that. If you go to Dubai, I mean, Dubai is the Disneyland of the Middle East, okay? Yeah. It's so commercialized. Like, I go down there just to have, like, a breath of fresh air, you know what I mean? But a lot of people who go there say, like, oh, I was hoping that it would be a little more authentic. No, you're not going to get that unless you go out to Sharjah or you're going out to LA where ain't nobody trying to live. You know what I mean? Those are where the real people live, you know? But you in Dubai and Abu Dhabi, you're going to be Sally with blonde hair, blue eyes, and stuff like that. There's tons of excess. But being a black female abroad, you're going to get a lot of looks. For example, I went to Sri Lanka like 4 years ago for Christmas break. I was there for 2 weeks. I'm walking. I had to walk up this mountain to go for a hike. I had to leave at 2 o'clock in the morning. And so when I'm coming down, the whole country of Sri Lanka is going up this mountain to give like a pilgrimage or something like that. And so there's monks, there's nuns or whatever going up this mountain, whatever. Again, monks. Monks are there, right? I'm walking down the mountain with my friend Issa, and then I see a monk and a soldier look at me and laugh at me. I don't care, whatever. I'm different. I get it, whatever. I'm about to walk past the monk, okay? The monk windmills and slaps my butt. A monk! He's wearing an orange robe. He is a monk, okay? I swear, I was eight hours into that hike. If I had the energy, that would have been a dead monk, okay? All I could do was just give a couple of breathy curse words or whatever, but that was it. But I think that story like that happened to me everywhere.
Buddha does not approve of that.
Yeah, but don't even think about going to Turkey, not Turkey. Don't even think about going to Istanbul. I call it Istanbul poop. Okay, because I got the worst treatment. I mean, just not the worst treatment, just like, in a way, it was just like almost animals. Like animals where they were just like clawing at me. Now, if you go to other parts of Turkey, it's fun, whatever. But I'm just saying, being a black female abroad, expect to be treated like like a zoo animal, just like, oh my god, I can't believe it. And the thing is, like, look at me. Like, you should see his hair. Like, it's huge, whatever. You see a black female, dark skin, with his big hair. Like, I'm going to be a celebrity. I'm going to be a celebrity, whatever. But it's just like, expect to get treated a certain way if you're going to travel. Because the thing is, to be honest, black females, I mean, black people in general, we tend, they're not going to see us that often, okay? Oh, and another thing that you should probably pay attention to. There is a heavy, heavy, heavy saturation of black educators in the Middle East. There's a heavy saturation.
That's why I talked to you, Yolanda, because of that. Yes.
Yeah, there's a heavy saturation. So the thing is, like, in the Middle East and in Asia, if you want to get your start, you have to start off in the Middle East and Asia. But sometimes, I hate to say it, a lot of black people, they get, in a way, trapped or comfortable. The thing is, it's really, really easy to stay in the Middle East and get comfortable. You can have a maid, you can have food delivered to you, you'll never have to leave your house for anything. It's a really, really, really nice lifestyle. But you'll get trapped there. And you, if you want to leave, if you want to move on to a better school, you have to do stuff that's going to, like, diversify yourself. So when I was talking to people who were like, I've been in the Middle East for 8 years, what am I going to do? I'm like, hey, you need to get IB certified. Hey, you need to go do this. You need to, like, push yourself out there, because to be honest, you are another black female in the Middle East. And the thing is, they just, like, to be honest, like, they typecast you. And I asked a couple of administrators at the search fair in Boston. I was like, hey, complete honesty, just give me the truth. When you see, like, a lot of, like, black females or black men, whatever, applying for these positions, I'm like, don't hold back. I'm like, what do you think? They're like, oh, we just think that you guys are another person just trying to, like, live this lifestyle. Oh, and trying to live an Instagram lifestyle. That's a lot of people. I mean, I get it. The pictures are nice. You want to live that life, whatever. But there's a lot of people coming over here trying to live that Instagram lifestyle. And then getting stuck here. But the thing is, again, it's a good life, whatever. But if you want something better for yourself, you're going to have to, like, do something different than anybody else. And if you want to move to a different school, don't keep on making lateral moves to other schools. Like, okay, well, it might be a little bit better pay. No, you need to have a better rank of school, whatever. But
right. That's
just my little spiel.
Because I know a lot of opportunities have come up for the Middle East, so I wanted to make sure that was covered, because I've seen a lot of things for Abu Dhabi, Dubai, and Kuwait, and Jordan, and I'm like, this needs to be touched upon. So I thought,
yeah. And the thing is, there are tons and tons and tons of schools, and there are tons of crap schools. Excuse me, I'm sorry. There are tons of awful, awful schools. The thing is, there's horror stories about some of the schools in the Middle East, because, like, they're pop-ups. Like, these families, these rich families, they're like, oh, that'll make really good money. We'll build a school, whatever. And then they have no idea what it is to have, like, a proper educational system. They have no clue. They just have money. They throw people in there.
And that was one reason why I stayed true to my guns, and I only wanted to work with the Department of Defense. For stuff like that. I didn't want any issues. I wanted safety. You know, if something happens, even though I'm here near North Korea, if something happens, they're getting me out of here. You know, we have these little precautionary things that we do. So, and my brother's been here 3 years. He said, he's never told me, you know, we couldn't go to work today because of blah, blah, blah. You know, but yeah, things that you're talking about, that, yeah, unacceptable. But I haven't experienced that, you know, the excessive staring or people trying to touch my hair. I don't know if it's because the Americans have been over here for such a long time with the military. For example, a Korean lady does my hair. She will straighten it and braid it. And I asked her before I sat in the chair, I said, how long you been braiding hair? How long you been doing black people's hair? And she said, over 20 years. I said, oh. You know, so yeah, over 20 years. Yeah.
Wow.
So being here, it is kind of nerve-wracking, because you don't know. And that was another thing. You don't know about where you're going to get certain foods that you like. Do you have to constantly, you know, contact home for them to send you various things? Or how are you going to get your hair done? And I'm natural. Who's going to braid it when I want it braided? You know, you don't really think about all these things. But when you get here, you realize, oh my goodness, I'm really not the only Black person. Yeah. I was talking to Keisha, and I was asking her some things about some foods, and she told me that there are several international shops that she, you know, visits. So you might feel like you're just kind of out there, but you can still gain access to certain things that you like. Like,
certain elements of okay, so I have two more questions before we almost get ready to wrap up. Okay, so what would you have known, or what would you have wished you knew before you got working internationally? What did you wish before coming? Everybody got it?
Yes.
What did we wish we'd known before we came overseas?
Yes. It's like with the job or just... Okay. We'll talk about housing in a second. That's... Somebody has a question. We're going to answer these... We're going to talk these two questions, and then we'll take everybody else's questions. So, MC, come back with that question about housing in a few minutes. Okay.
Go ahead. Okay, I'm going to answer this, but so the thing is, before when I got cut out, you guys were talking about sort of like culture shock and stuff. Mm-hmm. To be honest, I didn't really go through culture shock because I didn't really have all of these American expectations in a different country. I was like, I'm coming here, this is what it's going to be, or whatever. So I completely rolled with it. You know, I mean, there are frustrations or whatever, but I completely rolled with it. I just forgot what I was going to say. Let me get my brain mess together. It's 5:05 in the morning. Go to Eric real quick. Let me think about what I was about to say.
Sure. Well, I don't know what I would have known had I come abroad. I think that, well, like I said, number one is when the vacation period ends, it's preparing for the reality of what it is. It hit me hard when I was like missing my nephew and niece's birthdays and recitals and people, good food. This is great food here. Let me take that back. But New York City is New York City, hello. Yes. So I'm like, home cooking, things like that. I think those things. Number two is the financial emergency. Is what I wish I would have kind of known how to prepare for coming here, because there was sort of mess ups between getting reimbursed, and I took a big hit, you know, coming here as far as spending money, shipping things and whatever, and I was gonna get it all back, but it took a while, processes, paperwork that Robin mentioned in South Korea, right? Lots of paperwork in China as well. That took a while, so I was really struggling around October when I was like, I've been here 2 months, can I get reimbursed? Those types of things, it's not what you're used to in that way, but it's not something you can't get over. But those are the things, and then that's about it, really. The other things I think I've gotten you too used to, probably, but those are the biggest things. The work culture has been very different, very, very different here as well, in good and bad ways, but yeah.
I think I would have wished, like knowing what I know now, I probably would have bought more clothes with me, certain types of clothing.
I brought everything.
18,000 pounds.
I was under the impression, like, I bought like really, really professional clothing. And the area that I'm in, it's like being in Florida. It's very, you know, it's hot. It's hot and humid. And so I realized the high heels and all of that other stuff, I'm like, oh no, this is not that. And I wish I could have bought a different wardrobe. And then sometimes too, because I'm heavy set, sometimes it's hard for me to find clothes. You know what I mean? And so it's just like, if you're small and petite, that's cool. But I'm chunky and petite. I'm small. You know what I mean? So it's just like, oh, they definitely not gonna have my. But you can get things made. You can get things made here.
Things made.
very cheap. And like, all you have to do is just like bring in a magazine picture, like, hey, I want this made, and they'll make it for you.
Mm-hmm. Same in Korea.
Yeah. Oh, you are adventurous. I just go home and get stuff. I go to Old Navy when I go home, and I'm like, bloop, 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 suitcase, back to China. Sorry.
A couple things that I think I wish I would have known is that I wouldn't have direct support. I didn't have direct support, either from another counselor, especially in the building. I've never really been the only counselor. The high school that I left, I was the lead, and at one point it was five of us, then it was four of us, then it was three. You know, always someone to just bounce things off of, not to solely rely on what the principal says. The principal knows what she knows, but she's still not a counselor. So the counselors are these warm and fuzzy, we're looking out for the kid, you know, holistically. And so that was, you know, interesting. And then all the stuff I didn't know about, shipping the car, and I didn't have anything really, but, you know, get the license and then get a temporary tag, then go back and get a permanent tag. It was a lot of moving parts. And I think I just wish I had known about those moving parts before I arrived, because it just seemed like, do this, do this, do this, do this. It was all these things, and they had to be done within a certain time frame, or you couldn't, you know, drive your car on the base, or you couldn't do this, you couldn't do that. And so I'm just like, I wish I had known ahead of time.
Absolutely.
Okay, I remember what I was gonna say. Okay. So this is the one thing that bugged me. So I didn't have any issues with like the culture shock coming over here, but what did bug me was the people who had no experience being overseas. It was them not understanding that when you come over here, like, stuff is going to get different, and especially just culturally, how insensitive people will be.
Yes.
Like, that, like, I talked to Keisha a couple of weeks ago or months ago about this, about how we have a lot of nannies, we have a lot of maids. Typically, they're Indian, they're Filipino, they're Chinese, Somali, whatever, and they wear like this maid outfit, whatever. One of the teachers at a school that's down the street, whatever, decided that they were going to come to school dressed as the nanny. You know what I mean? Holding food as like the nannies would when they were coming to pick up their kids. And I was like, what part of that don't you understand is like insensitive? You know what I mean? Like, what part, like, don't you understand? Like, and that tells me, like, we're expected to be like this international community, mm-hmm. yet we have, but these people who are coming over here have like this, puts out like this international mindset, whatever, but they're so closed-minded. I mean, and the thing is, like, what really is me is, like, the women who, like, wear the hijab or wear the niqab, and the niqab is where, like, they cover, like, half of, like, their face, and then there'll be people over here who'll be like, oh, I can't stand those ninjas, and I'm just like, no, you do not come to this country. You do not come to this country, you take their money, you go on these nice vacations, and they call them ninjas. I'm like, check your privilege, and, you know, I'm like, what are you doing? So that's the type of stuff that just infuriates me. Like, we are guests in their country. We need to adhere to, like, to their issues, you know what I mean? I mean, to their, like, lifestyle. So I'm like, don't come over here acting all crazy, you know, spouting your Western ideas, whatever. And then the second thing is, that even though I am knowledgeable in a certain area, because I am a female, it's like, I'm not going to listen to you. So the thing is, it pisses me off and getting mad, but I've had to find ways of getting my point across without getting credit for it through, like, my male superior, Issa, whatever, the head of counseling. I'm just like, okay, what's my goal? You need this to happen, okay? Even though, like, you know this is right, you know that, like, all the research, whatever, is right, whatever, they're not going to listen to you. Give it to Issa, have Issa do it. So if it's coming from a man, they're going to do it. Because it doesn't matter how many times I say it, doesn't matter how many times, whatever, it's because I'm a female. And it's taken me 5 years to finally have people just say, okay, Yolanda says it, let's just do it. And now I'm leaving. You know what I mean? So I just like, those are the two things. It's like,
I just took time.
Complexity of other people and just like being a female. So, yeah.
Absolutely.
It's a man. Listen, I just want when people decide to do this that they come in with realistic expectations and like come into the culture, learn about it, check yourself. Because just like what Yolanda said, I have people. The majority of the staff at my school is the kids are all Chinese. The majority of the staff is white, and there's like one Indian teacher. One black teacher, one Filipino teacher. That's it. That's our people of color.
Yeah.
But as the counselor, kids come to me telling me things that the teachers have said to them, like derogatory things. And like even in my own presence, like, you know, I've heard a teacher say, what kind of name is Shan Shan? Or you know, like Ming Ming or whatever. Something like that. Then I'm just like, are you really, really, really saying that? So I think it's important to like have a great deal of cultural sensitivity. That's so important. If you, whatever school you go to, if you get there, ask about that. Ask about that in the interview process. Now we're going to wrap up. I see a lot of people asking questions about like our packages. What does that include? The apartments and stuff like that. So I want to take that question. And for the viewers, whatever questions you may want to ask, please ask it now in the live chat so that way we can answer those questions before we end the broadcast. So for me, my package included round trip airfare from New York to China and back. It included free housing. I have a 3-bedroom apartment, 2 bathrooms, and it's just me, single person. I have no kids. I'm not married. It's just me right here. I get health insurance to get my salary. There's also retirement. I get my retirement pay at the end of the school year. So for each year, they give it to you in a lump sum check. So I'll get my lump sum check in June. Our last day of school is June 9th. So I'll get June and July's check plus the retirement check. What else? I don't have to pay for utilities. They give us about, what is it, $1,000 for our utilities here. And you're not going to use it all. You won't use it all. So essentially, I'm just paying for food. That's it. The Wi-Fi, the VPN, they supply that. Professional development, I get $800 individual. And there's also departments, so I'm able to go to different conferences and so forth, and they pay state taxes. Great question. The salary is tax-free. Now, my other co-host, they can chime in on this, and Yvette too. I think after, you have to make over a certain amount to be taxed.
I think $120,000 a year.
Yeah.
I think it was like
$90,000.
I just went back to the States like in February because I hadn't done taxes in 3 years. Sorry, Department of Defense people. Because I just kind of went abroad. That's one of the things. I just kind of went abroad. It was like, bye. And then they were like, no, in 2013, you work half the year, obviously, in the United States. So, you know, IRS was like, knock, knock. What's up? You owe us this year that you haven't paid. I was like, whoops. So my accountant told me it was like over 100K. If I am correct, it is over 100K that you begin to pay.
Marla said,
109K. There you go. That's what I thought it was the number, roughly. Yeah.
91,000, 92,000.
Oh.
Yeah, Marla just said it was 109K. So,
yeah.
If you make under that, you won't have to pay. But like my job, they gave me a letter saying that where I work and all the other stuff, and I just send it to the tax man, and the tax man will take care of that.
Yeah.
But that's pretty much my package. What about you guys?
My package included, I've already said, shipping my car, shipping my household goods, 18,000 pounds. I have a retirement account. It doesn't come in a lump sum, but the government matches it dollar for dollar. So it's 100% match. I get my salary. I have housing. So right now I'm in a 4-bedroom, 2-bath condo. I'm on the 15th floor, which is the tallest for my building. I also have a patio and a deck.
What?
Yeah.
I'm coming over.
I could have had a pet if I wanted to, but I don't have a pet. No children. What else? Health insurance is taken out. And since I work for the government of the United States, taxes are already coming out of my check. So, salary. Yeah.
Another thing is, do you get paid in local currency or do you get paid in like in Korean won or do you get paid in U.S. dollars?
USD, United States. Mm-hmm. And it just is electronic going to my account. That's it.
Wow. Okay.
My salary is, I get paid a U.S. salary, but it's given to me in Chinese RMB.
Oh. And yes. We get paid every 2 weeks.
See, we get paid at the end of the month. Okay. We get paid once a month. But what happens is they can direct deposit it into my bank account in New York. So that's fine.
Wow.
What about you, Yolanda? What was your package like?
Sort of like they'd be like round trip flight.
I forget the round trip.
You know, health insurance. The insurance in Kuwait is like, it's quite good. A lot of, I had quite a few of my friends have surgery. My friend Christina, she had like surgery for like fibroids or something like that. Ooh. And it was amazing doctor. And they did like this high testing on her. So she's great for the next 10 years. There's no. I think dental is covered. Half of that is covered. My apartment, there's like 4 different apartment buildings. This one, I mean, it's pretty average. Like they give you like new furniture and stuff. But the thing is, I had to fight. My first year when I came in, I had an allergic reaction because there was like a cat that was in here before and I almost blew up. Then I had to move me to a different place. And I had to fight every single year to make sure that everybody got new furniture or it was like changed every like 2 or 3 years. Now there's like new furniture and appliances, whatever, thanks to me.
Okay.
Here for our school, and some other schools do it too, we have a bus that comes to pick us up in the morning and then drop us off at school. And certain times after school, they drop us back off, whatever. And then we have a shopping bus that'll come like every Wednesday after the bus drops us off. We get our stuff and we go to the grocery store for about an hour and we come back. Now, that is what our school does for us. Some of the schools in Kuwait do it. Some schools say that they're supposed to do it. They don't do it. It's a tax-free salary, but Kuwait is also tax-free, and so is the rest of like the Gulf countries, which is like Oman, UAE. Ain't nobody trying to go to Yemen. What's it called? I can't think. Whatever, Gulf countries, whatever. But the thing is, that's about to change. So I forgot what happened, but I think that everybody in the Gulf kind of realized that hey. We cannot sustain this type of living anymore.
Yeah.
And we need to grow our country. We need to have like, you know, like a social security or like a backup plan or whatever. So now that they're going to start having something called like a VAT tax. So you will probably see a lot of people clear out of this, slowly clear out of like this, this area because of like the VAT tax. But they're trying to do that like, you know, slowly because they do understand that the only reason to be here is to make money, especially Kuwait, because there ain't no clubs, there ain't no alcohol, there ain't no pork, there ain't nothing. What else? So yeah, it's tax-free.
Wow.
Yeah, that's the main reason for being here. And the thing is because there's nothing to do here in Kuwait. You save your money.
That is true.
And the tutoring. I don't know about how it is over there for you guys. Tutoring is huge here. You can double your income by tutoring. Like when I was tutoring, I hate doing it because I'm just lazy. I made roughly 70 US dollars an hour tutoring.
Wow.
Yes. Yes. I made like 70 US dollars an hour tutoring. And so a lot of people, they would just send all of their income home and they would just live off of tutoring. Mm-hmm. So that's like another reason why people come here. And then there's something called the indemnity. This is throughout Kuwait. Anybody who works in Kuwait. So every year that you work here, you get a half month salary. You get a half month salary, okay? And then after your fifth year, it turns into a full month salary, okay? And so once you like leave the country, whatever, based off of your last salary, whatever, that's the amount of money that you're going to take with you. So that's sort of like your retirement. But we call it indemnity. So if I had stayed one more year instead of a half month, it would have turned over to a whole month.
Wow.
And I mean, I could have taken a chunk of change home, but you know,
wow.
I need to have a better quality of life, so I'm leaving.
Yes, it is. Yeah. I have something. What about you?
For me, it was the same. I wrote there, generally packages will be generous in the Middle East and Asia. The same could be true for schools on the African continent. So to keep that in mind, a lot of international schools. So don't be swayed by what you might think. But generally, I was offered similar to everybody, minus the car. That was amazing. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to drive in China because I love my life. So
yes.
No, that's all right.
Yes.
So I've got a fully furnished apartment. Because mm-hmm. in at least in Shenzhen in China, apartments usually come furnished with some very not fashionable, yes. But it comes with furniture. So it'll be fully furnished with a bed and whatnot, right? Hello. I got my rent is paid for. It goes into my check the way they do it, and then it's paid for. My utilities are covered, so cell phone is really cheap. I pay more for my cell phone to keep my cell phone in New York than I do here. Here I pay probably $30 a month for internet at home. Hello, minus the unstableness, but the instability. But I get a round trip airfare home every summer, paid for. I also get one professional development, so I go to one conference a year. This year happens to be in New York, so that's working out. I'm also leaving this year, so I'm transitioning to an international school in Europe, and I am full proof that packages are quite generous in Asia as opposed to Europe. So for you people glamorize maybe with living in Paris and London, believe me, I asked a lot of my colleagues before I took this job, I'm going to be moving to Germany, about the cost of living and about the pay cut that I'm taking to do this. Because the school is IB, for example. So people that might not be familiar with our international baccalaureate, I have no experience working in that. And I'd be working as a full-time school counselor, aside from saying once in my life that I lived in Europe. But the package is significantly different. They offered me a contract, and I'm like, where's my flight home every year? And they're like, flight home? You could just go to the airport and grab a flight. Figure it out. You're 8 hours from New York. And I was like, something to live. Taxes are higher. Here in China, I'm at like a 20%, I think, tax rate with the RMB. I don't get paid in US dollar like he's just to my left. I get paid in RMB local currency. I do not get taxed in the US because I'm under that threshold as well. So indeed, flight home is a must, I think, for anybody who takes an offer. Look at the apartment well, what is offered and what is paid for as well. And professional development, because you want to, like Yolanda said, she's down here for me. You want to professionally develop yourself, right? You set up here as well, actually. You want to be able to travel to conferences and add things to your resume to diversify that experience so you don't get stuck. You don't get just comfortable where you're at. But flight, definitely. Health insurance is covered in China as well. I went to the clinic just the other day. It's fully covered for me as well.
Good.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so at this time, we're going to ask those viewers, if you have any questions, please post it in the live chat section so that way we can answer them for you. and then we have maybe about 5 or 6 more minutes to do that, and we're going to log out because we're tired. I'm tired.
Actually, no, I'm just trying to
do
this. Okay, any questions? Any questions? Right now? Okay, do you usually spend time with other expats and people from your school, or have you ventured out? I will take that question. My school is like a bubble, like I said. And so what I realized with the culture here, it's like they feel that we work together. So my job has also found me all my best friends. And everybody hangs out with each other. For me, I don't like that because I need the separation between work and my personal life. So I have my own friends, which consists of Eric. Where you at, Eric?
I'm right here.
Yes. And then Marla's in the chat group, and there's some other friends that we have, and we do things together when we can. Occasionally, like Yolanda said, like her school has a bus that takes people shopping every so often. Ooh. Our school does that as well because we're in the sticks. So we're able to go shopping either in Guangzhou, we go to IKEA. Yes, there's IKEA in China. Or we go to SeaWorld, which is a very expat area. And so we do that. But do I hang out with them, my coworkers, hard? No, I do not. Because I need that separation. Because I don't want any problems to develop in our professional relationship.
Absolutely. You also don't want to learn too much about your counselors, about your, the people that you work with. I think that as an expat, you're going to see this in other countries. You're like, oh my God, somebody from close to where I'm from, even if that person is from Idaho and you're from like Florida. And you're like, you know that in the States, we would probably never meet, unless you're in New York, of course, where everybody meets or something like that. But you really find kinship at times with people that are similar to you, that have some type of experience that you're like, my goodness, you can at least relate to getting used to this. But sometimes many expats, especially here in Shenzhen and in China, I'm sure you've seen it, they will sit you down over a glass of water or wine or beer, whatever you take, or vodka straight up, thank you. And they will just tell you their life. And they'll be like, and I had this happen to me, and then my husband left me, then my wife did. I was like, oh, I've known you for 4 years.
Yes.
Oh, wow, that's a lot. Oh, dear, okay. You know, you do the slow walk back, and I'm like, they just do what I call the expat gush. They're like, and I'm like, be my friend. And I'm like, oh, yes, call you. I will call you. You.
Not really.
So, but also, you don't want that to happen with your colleagues because you might see them doing something that you might raise an eyebrow real quick, and if they're in whatever state or whatever they might have said, and then you see them on Monday or at work every day. So those are things that I like to, I think Keisha does the same, which is a little bit of a separation between my colleagues and my friends, exactly. Yeah. So I have something different, you know, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm kind of the same. There are a few. I had to check out your character. You're too negative. Yes. Are you always talking about kids? Are you always talking about the principal? And I work like this with the principal because it's just me. So I can't be in constant communication with you. I just can't. And I have learned to just create this. You want to go to lunch? Nah. You know, I'll make you feel bad, but I'm not going. It's just not going to happen. Now, there is one lady at work that I'm pretty close with, and her husband works right across the street at the high school. We hang out, you know, period. I was just eating chicken with them last night. Kareem is making very good fried chicken, in case you didn't know. Very good fried chicken. But you do have to separate, because some people will get you caught up in, like my principal says, a kimchi. And that's just some stuff all stirred up. Case in point, we all know what we're really supposed to do, right? We already had that discussion. Some people asked me just at random times, well, how do you like it here? How are things going? And I might have mentioned something where typically counselors don't do lunch duty, or typically counselors don't you know, monitor the kids while they're playing outside. They went back and told the principal that I don't like the job and that I'm not supposed to be doing certain things. They totally twisted what I said. You asked me a question, I responded, and then you go and report something that didn't really even happen. So I'm just learning this, when people say things, you know, I just give them the non-verbals. You know, well, what do you think about that? I don't, you know, I don't really think because people are just turning things around. So I'm just, you know, whatever. So it's really good to separate. It's kind of like church and state. Just once you find out certain people, just stay away.
Yeah.
For me, I have both. Like the first thing that my coworker, my head, whatever, my first year here, she said, in order for you to survive, you need to make friends outside of the work environment in order for you to survive. But the thing is like I was real fortunate. I've been really blessed. A lot of the people who I work with, I love. And I hang out with every single day. Like my counseling department, there's me, I'm 9-10. There's Isa, who's the HOD of counseling, 11-12. And then there's Christina McDade, she's also 11-12. And we hang out with each other throughout the day, you know what I mean? And then on the weekend, like we can't get enough of each other. Like we've already planned our flight back home when we're ending our time here, June 15th, whatever. We're going to be on the same flight. Like, can't get enough of each other. So the thing is, I've been really, really fortunate that the people I work with, I'm in love with. And then my best friend, she came from one school, and then she came to my school. I mean, there was a point where I legit was going to choke her. But the thing is, we're past that. I still love her. You get that for me? But the thing is, like, yeah, I have friends in school. I have friends outside of school. It's up to you. But like Robin was saying, like, before I was very hi, like I'm the one that like we'll take you to the fabric suit, maybe we'll take you to Taylor, I'm gonna show you where this is and da 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 da. And I think it was last year I just hit a funk and I was just like hashtag no new friends, I'm just keeping the friends that I have. I don't wanna talk to anybody, don't bother me, whatever. Mm-hmm. Because I was just like, you know what? I'm friended out. Like I'm done. I don't need to build more relationships. I'm popular. Are you hearing me? So, I have friends in the school. I have friends outside of the school. Oh, the only thing that's weird is like I have no local friends, and I mean like I have no Kuwaiti friends because Kuwaitis usually only hang out with other Kuwaitis. So, if you come to the Middle East and you were expecting to have like Kuwaitis, like local friends, don't expect that. Don't expect that at all.
One of the biggest things, actually, now you mentioned it, maybe to start wrapping up, is the language thing. I think I had unrealistic expectations of becoming like a Chinese scholar. You really have, you are so busy at work and you are so exhausted on the weekends that trust and bequeath, you are not going to pick up a book on the weekends or when you're time off and study the language, even though I do. I mean, if you look in my little section right here, like, well, besides that hat, I have a whole section of books of Chinese. So I do make time to take, I do take the time to learn Chinese, but I'm, you know, in my early 20s, 33, and it's hard to pick up a language at this age. That's the reality of it. So it, like Yolanda said, it'll make interaction with locals really, really tough. Not impossible, but you might not be like, oh, yes, I am Kuwaiti. Oh, yes, I am Chinese. A lot of people are like, am I going to become less American? Am I going to? You're not. Believe me, you're not. You'll realize just how much from where you're from you are. I never really realized that until I came here and I was like, this makes no sense. We would never do this. This would never happen. And I said, I got to stop saying that because I'm not in, you know, New York or wherever. I'm in China, I'm in Shenzhen, and this is the way stuff is here. But the more you learn the language, make an effort to at least get a xie xie, or I forgot how to say it in Arabic, right? or, you know, in Korean, exactly. Get a little, at least a little bit goes a long way. I think everybody
can. Yes.
Okay, so
Yeah.
I want to thank everybody, especially my co-host, for waking up so early. Thank you so much for waking up at the crack of dawn. Thank you. Eric and Robert, thank you so much. For the viewers, I want to thank you. We have tuning in right now 115 people. And I think that's great for our very first blab. So I want to thank you for tuning in. Hopefully we can do some more of these things for you so that way you can learn more about this process and how to do it. If you have any questions, you can always ask them on Professional School Counselors on Facebook or at School Counselors of Color on Twitter. I'm sorry, I was reading what Yvette said. Yes, you can give a shout out.
Okay, yes. I'm going to give a shout out to Miss Keisha. And thank you for this forum. And thank you for your No, seriously, because I see that I didn't know she was in here. Mariana, who I found through this group to replace me. So the thing is, like, and I want to say, Mariana, we are so stoked that you're coming here. I keep on talking to you after the kids. I took your picture off of Facebook and I showed the kids who you are and stuff like that. So I'm saying, thank you for this forum, because if not for this, I wouldn't have been able to find an amazing replacement, because I don't know about to let anybody have my baby. So I'm so happy that thank you for you, so I can find her, so that our school can be taken care of. So thank you. Thank you, Eric.
Absolutely.
And thank you, Robin. Yeah.
Yay!
Yeah. It was so much fun. This was so much fun. I'm glad we were able to connect. All these viewers, just awesome.
Awesome.
It was great. Guys, it's 10 o'clock.
I know.
I'm going to work out.
I'm going back to sleep. So again, thank you for watching. It was great. This was a wonderful experience, and we hope to do this again. If you'd like to see this happen, please hit us up on Twitter. Or Facebook group, and let us know what is it that you want to know, so that way we can put it together.
Happy Saturday. Happy Good Friday for whoever's out there celebrating as well. All right.
He bled and he died. Father God.
Yes.
Happy Sabbath. All right, guys. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.